On behalf of the Coronado Public Library, welcome to this conversation with Bonnie Garmus. Warwick's Bookstore is the leading bookstore in our region, and we are just very grateful to be able to partner with them. Let's welcome the Director of Events at Warwick's, Julie Savinsky.
Before I start, though, one of the things we love to do is I love to take a picture of all of you because I think a lot of you have a book in your hand. And so that's my favorite thing to do is to see all of you, those lovely books in your hand. So hold that up and let me take a photo real quick. All right, let's see if I can find my camera. Yeah. Oh, yeah, Bonnie, you want to come out for this? Ladies and gentlemen, Bonnie Garmus. Okay, here she is. You want to stand here? You want to stand there and I will take this picture? Okay. You're going to be in it.
Am I facing you?
You're facing me. Oh, I've got that light, though. That's really bad. Okay, we're going to take two, because we're going to take this side of the audience, and we're going to take this side of the audience. Oh, you look fit. There you go. You can walk and talk. There you go. Perfect. Okay, well, see, yeah. Thanks. So she's really not introduced yet, so... I have some thank yous I have to make. So first of all, I do want to thank Sean and the Coronado Library for the partnership on this event. I've known Sean for a number of years, and it's always awesome partnering with him. But I also need to thank our publishing partner, Doubleday, and acknowledge the importance of that partnership with Warwick's. If it weren't for them and their generosity, we all would not be here this evening. So let's give a round of applause to Doubleday for that. Some quick housekeeping. If you purchased a book tonight for the event, it is a signed copy. It is pre-signed. So Bonnie will be doing a signing after. So if you want it personalized, you can get it personalized. There are more signed copies for sale out there. So if you need more for some gifts, some Mother's Day thing coming up, I don't know. You can get some more that way. And there will be time for us to take some audience questions after their conversation. I'll be standing with a microphone in the back there. And you'll see me, so you can come there. And the operative word there is a question. So, just saying that. So, now on to the program. Jane Mitchell, who will be conducting tonight's interview, is a 28-time Emmy Award-winning broadcast journalist, TV personality, and author. She helped create the TV home of the Padres for 15 years, Channel 4 San Diego. With her signature style, the program that became a book and is now a production company, One-on-One, delved into the hearts, minds, and scrapbooks of athletes and legends like Dick Enberg, Tony Gwynn, and several others. Jane is a true San Diego legend herself. On to Bonnie. There's my reading. Yeah, let's give Jane a round of applause there. Bonnie Garmus is the number one New York Times bestselling author of Lessons in Chemistry. Woohoo! It's been on the New York Times list for 41 weeks. It's been translated into 40 languages and is in 35 territories, and almost 1.4 million copies have been sold in the US alone. Huge. She's a copywriter and creative director who has worked widely in the fields of technology, medicine, and education. She does some amazing activities like open water swimming and rowing, was born here in California, currently lives in London with her husband and dog, whose name is 99. So I have a feeling we're going to be talking about dog names this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Jane Mitchell and Bonnie Garmus. I don't know.
Thank you.
Hello. Well, welcome, Bonnie, Coronado, my alma mater, by the way, and and to beautiful San Diego as well. I like to get a quick sense of our audience. How many of you have already read the book? Wow.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And so how many you've just bought it and you're going to read it, just so I can see? Okay. And how many are aspiring writers who might be here to be inspired by Bonnie? We've got a few. Okay. Very good. Well, I just wanted to be sort of upfront here. I am not normally a reader of novels. my favorite normally is biographies, and it's what I do, what I interview, what I read. That being said, when I saw this 300 and something page book, I said, oh my, and I read it and I was absolutely delighted. It was so much fun, very thought-provoking, I thought, as well, super creative, and it made me laugh too. So made me laugh and made me think and made me, I was absolutely just enthralled with the character. So thank you for opening my eyes to a new genre that I had not been part of really since, you know, other than Cat in the Hat with my daughter. I like to start at the beginning to help people understand not just the success of the book, but really at the beginning for your story. Give us a little bit of the highlights, where you grew up, who were your inspirations, tell us about your parents, and growing up at that time, late 50s, early 60s, what was life, what did you see out there from your perspective?
Well, I was born in Riverside, California. I lived there till I was 13. We moved abroad. I have three sisters. Two of them are in the audience.
Aww.
Yay! And I don't know, you know, I was pretty young. I set this book at a time when my mom was the mom. So really, Elizabeth Zott is my mom's age. My mom is not Elizabeth Zott, but this is sort of a salute to that generation of women. And yeah, I think growing up in Riverside was pretty good. Let's see, what can I tell you?
Well, what did you aspire to be?
I wanted to be a novelist when I was little, and I wrote my first book at age 5. And my children found it in our basement, and they ridiculed me with it all the time. They quote it all the time. And so I've tried to hide it, and they keep finding it. I've kept it all these years, and they really want to know why, because there's only one character, there's absolutely no plot or character development.
Didn't you write another one at 12, though?
Yeah, I wrote another one at 12, and my incredible librarian at school put it in the school library, and I checked every day to see if someone had checked it out, and no one ever did.
So what was the dream for you in terms of what you saw yourself doing as a career?
I knew I wanted to be a writer, and I kind of got into copywriting. It's highly creative work, for me at least. I was doing a lot of concept work, and I really enjoyed the people I worked with. I worked with a lot of producers and directors and a lot of illustrators and photographers. And collectively, we'd work together, and it was like, you know, it's like having a band, and then you're sort of a family against the client. But we were really, I worked with a lot of people. I was very lucky to work with a lot of highly talented people.
Did you yourself ever feel, I mean, you were seeing what was happening in society and out there at that time in the 60s and going into the 70s. Did you feel that you are a woman, like Helen Reddy said, you know, part of that where it was fine, you could just do what you wanted? Or did you ever feel a sense that maybe you would be limited?
Oh, I knew I was limited. I tried to get a paper route when I was, I think, 9. And I had a pretty good arm, right? And and I remember going down to the Riverside Press. My mom drove me, and I tried to apply for this job. And they said, no, only boys can do this. And they said, because boys have stronger arms. Oh, really? Doubtful. Anyway, wow. I did not get the job.
Wow. So that would have been what year? 9 years old. Oh, sorry. We're right in the same category, so I
yeah,
don't feel
no,
terrible
what,
asking
that's like
that.
1966 or 67. I'm not good at math. I can't even compute that. But anyway, it was somewhere in that area.
What was your dad like?
Oh, my dad was great. He was an entomologist. He was really, really into insects. And, yeah, we were never allowed to kill anything, although we certainly wanted to. He was, I think, you know, he had 4 daughters. My dad was a super athlete, and he taught us to be athletes, I think. And I think we all kind of followed that. There's not a single one of my sisters who can't belt a ball out of the ballpark. absolutely, we could all do that. We used to play workups all the time on the weekends. So I think for us, I think all of us were pretty athletic growing up. And then to discover that there was no place for that outlet for us was a bitter pill.
So going through college and going into your career, then did you feel you were kind of going along with as things were changing in the 60s and 70s?
Well, we moved abroad, so we were in South America. So
you didn't experience that?
No, well, I mean, we kind of did, but from a distance and, you know. But no, we certainly saw the changes, yeah.
So when did Elizabeth Zott come into your imagination?
She was a really tiny, tiny minor character in a story that I'd started, in a novel I'd started. I got halfway through this novel and I abandoned it, but she was in that. That novel started out with Madeline being the adult with a young child, and there's just a very slight mention of Elizabeth Zott and how she'd had this cooking show and she was a chemist and she was obviously depressed.
Hmm. Yeah.
That's the understatement of the year.
So take us to the time that you finally brought this, you said, it's time, I need to really tell this story.
Well, I'd written another book that went nowhere, and then one day I was in a meeting in the Bay Area, and I worked a lot in technology, and so often in technology you walk into the room and you're the only woman in the room. Now, I worked with a lot of these men for 10 years or so. I knew them pretty well. But this particular day, there's a new vice president who decided to attend the meeting. And I had just finished presenting my concepts for a major campaign. And no one said anything. And I didn't know what to make of it. I had a PowerPoint display and everything. And then a few minutes later, the vice president says, "You know what I think we should do?" And he's basically reading the PowerPoint. And he took complete credit for it. And no one else said anything. And I said, "You know, I just said all this stuff. In fact, all of these are my ideas." Mm. And no one said anything. Nothing. And so I left the meeting, and I went back to my desk, and I wrote the first chapter of Lessons in Chemistry. And that is called Constructive Anger.
You know, I think reading the book and seeing the many characters and how she's developed, it's amazing to me that your imagination can be so detailed. And where did all of these, her character development and what she did and all these things, where did that come from? Or how did you discover those things? What's your writing process that took us down the road with her story?
Well, my writing process is messy. And I think for Elizabeth Zott, I could hear her voice very clearly from the get-go. I knew exactly who she was and what she was going to say. The other characters, I had no idea. When I wrote that first chapter that day, I also wrote the last three sentences of the book. Mm. So I'd have sort of something to aim at. And amazingly, those three sentences still stand today. And the first chapter still stands today. Mm-hmm. So that's, phew. But I had to make up everything else and I didn't know what was going to happen. And so what I do is I kind of let characters walk on and then put them in a difficult situation and see how they show their colors. Mm. Because when you put people in conflict, all of their flaws come out.
Mm. So who are these? Would you call her like a composite of the things that you've observed or wanted over the years in a strong, independent woman? Because she has so many of those characteristics in women that we admire now or over time.
Well, you know, but she was, you're right, she was doing this at an age where women could not. She's actually based on the tenets of Stoicism written by Marcus Aurelius. She is a Stoic. She is full of self-responsibility. She's very honest and direct, but she's also logical and sensible. And I don't know about you, but I'm really tired of the irrational world we live in, and I really wanted to spend my day with somebody who was rational and sensible all the time and who just refused to put up with nonsense. And so that's her.
So how do you get from being almost done with the book to finishing it. Walk us through the website, the link that your daughter sent you, and how did that fall into the process of getting this book done?
Well, I'd written this other book, which I still like, but it was 700 pages long, and I couldn't get anyone to look at it. Literally, 98 agents said no, and they wouldn't look at a single word of it until the last 98. And then she did read 10,000 words, and she wrote me a really scathing email about how a debut novelist does not write 700 pages, that I didn't understand the economy of publishing, that who did I think I was? It went on and on. And then she said, but you know, it's pretty good. So she said, when you grow up and realize that you have to, she actually used those words, you have to write something of appropriate length, you can get back to me, but I never did. Yeah. And so what happened was I got 3/4 of the way through the book and I stopped working on it. And I think partly it was because I couldn't face the querying process again. It's pretty brutal. It's, you know, writing is 99% rejection. Mm. But then my daughter, I was moving to London, and I wasn't real excited about that either. We were living in Switzerland, and I think that might be probably my most favorite place I've ever lived. And my daughter sent me a link to the Curtis Brown online course called Write to the End of Your Novel. And she said, write to the end of your novel, Mom. And so I took this online course, and I did not write to the end of my novel. I failed the course. I mean, literally, they said, you failed.
Oh.
But no one else got to the end of their novel either. So then they invited me to come to their 3-month evening course, and I leapt at it because I knew no one in London, and I love meeting other writers. And my husband was traveling constantly. So it was just one night a week for 3 months, and it was just a bitch session of writers getting together and saying, how's your querying going? I hate everybody. And so that's really what it was. But that's where I met my agent, and it was just phenomenal. I couldn't believe it. So then she forced me to finish the book.
Right. So she had... She loved the story, or she loved you, or she, the whole combination, she could see that this had great promise. What were her comments?
Well, it's just strange. I mean, you know, you go through a lot of rejection as a writer. You're used to everyone, you know, just saying, no, not you. And I was at the party at the end of our 3-month course, and Felicity Blunt walked in. So Felicity Blunt is a huge name as an agent. I had long ago... seen a video of her, and I said to myself when I saw this YouTube video of Felicity Blunt, I said, boy, if I could have any agent in the world, it would be her, because she's super confident, and when she marches into a room and she tells somebody that, you know, they're going to do something for her author, they do it. So I thought, wow, wouldn't it be great to be represented by Felicity Blunt? And then that night, she walked into our party. And they said they were going to invite a lot of agents, but only 3 came. And Felicity started calling out names with the name tags, and we were all going up, and she called my name, she threw all the name tags down and led me to another room, and she said, I just love your book. And Felicity publishes a lot of thrillers, so I was pretty sure she had me mixed up with someone else, and I was really concerned that I would have to soon say, when she said, and when they stabbed that guy with a... So, you know, finally, 10 minutes into our conversation, she said, yeah, Elizabeth Zott. And I went, oh, thank God. Anyway, I made a lot of mistakes that night. Yeah.
But what's really incredible is that you, even though you had been a writer your whole life, this was your first published novel, and you were 64 when it came out.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, talk about inspiring, right? And who says you have to just do that when you're younger, but that we all have these new, you have a new chapter, literally a new chapter of your life. And I understand you quit your day job, is that right?
Well, or, I mean, you know, I am 65 now. Isn't that surprising? But yeah, I did. It was really great, too, because a client of mine called me in Seattle and said, you know, I know you're in town. Any chance you have time for a meeting? And I said, oh, no. I guess you don't read much, do you?
You know, we talk about the strength of women and of this story and how she's just, she's not going to put up with anything, but she has such a lovely way of doing it, I think, and the way you write and how she speaks. But this is not an anti-man, you know, book. It's anti-sexism.
Right.
There are some wonderful characters who are men
right.
in this book. So talk about how you sort of divvied up the different characters and the supporting cast.
Well, you know, I knew that there were going to be some bad guys, and their names reflect them. Donati is do not e, and Lebensmal means bad life in German. So, but the positive men, Calvin Evans, Wakely, Walter Pine, all of these men, Dr. Mason, all of these men are allies. They're what I look for in friends and people at work. And I wanted to make it really clear this is not about bashing men. It's about bashing sexism, which should really go away by now because it's a big waste of time for everybody in the entire world.
Just in terms of the writing and the process and getting it from your manuscript to the final, you clearly have a lot of editors, right? People look over, they're checking for story, for consistency, for accuracy. I mean, you had to do a lot of research, not only chemistry, but, you know, what was happening at that era so that you would get the right terms and things. Were there any changes made that you had to kind of fight for or want to rescue or say, wait a minute, this is my voice, don't change it?
Yeah.
Or were you happy with most of the changes?
No, I mean, you know, you have to go in with confidence. This is subjective. This is art. It's just like someone paints a painting and then you have someone come in and say, it needs more blue. You know, well, I mean, what if they said to Picasso during his blue period, more blue? I mean, he would have said, no, there's a lot already. So, I had some pushback on things, and there were some suggestions that I really enjoyed and took, but the smart thing is always to follow your own voice, and you shouldn't just lay down for an editor or for an agent, ever. I know a lot of writers who have never been published because they followed every single thing that their editor or their agent did. And these people are really smart, but it's your voice, it's your story. So you really have to keep the heart in it.
And I don't, no spoilers, you know, alerts here, but there were a few moments and, you know, I'm a mom, you're a mom, I got started later in life, but I found the character, this person, Elizabeth Zott, who, she didn't want to be a mom.
Right.
And yet, but she's an awesome mom, I think. I mean, I think she would, you know, the way she talks to her daughter and allows her to do things. But there's also a vulnerability to her that doesn't come out a lot, but just enough that made me go, oh, you know, I was happy that she found that joy of motherhood.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, that was my agent's influence. She goes, she's not a very good mom.
Oh.
And I said, well, she's unusual. And she said, she's letting her daughter play with knives in chapter 34.
Yeah, well.
Felicity was really helpful there because she said it might be getting a little, you know, she might need to show a little more vulnerability as a mom. And so that really directly, that comment really influenced me. And I wrote that in.
Well, very interesting. I need to meet Felicity.
I know.
Why do you think people have connected so much, not just with the book, but with this character? I mean, she's quite the heroine. What's the feedback that you get as you travel around, not just in the U.S., but wherever else you've been, or the emails or calls you've gotten? Tell us about how she has made an impression on men and women all over the world.
I think that really there's a little bit of Elizabeth Zott in all of us, right? Because who among us has not been shoved aside or passed over or talked over or hurt deeply or whatever? Who in this room has not suffered in some way? It's really hard to find anyone in the world who hasn't. And a lot of people keep that private. And so I think Elizabeth Zott goes through a lot. And one of the things I really wanted to show was her resilience to bad things happening and how they don't stop her from leading the life that she knows she's meant to lead. And so, you know, when I say I was writing my role model, that's what I was writing.
Toward the end of the book, I thought, oh, wow, that's such a great ending. And then there was another chapter. Oh, wow, that's such a great ending. And then there was another chapter. It was brilliant. I mean, it was just masterful. I sort of felt like it was bonus. And I think, but I'm not going to say, but all of the different things that you end up weaving and coming together, I as one reviewer said, you know, I wanted to keep going. And I also wanted her to be a real person.
Yeah.
You know, even though she is real in a way because she's a little bit of everybody. But I could also hear the voice from listening to television shows in the 50s and 60s. Mm-hmm. How many, you know, Father Knows Best or all those different shows. The way you wrote, I could hear that voice of someone that was familiar to me strictly through media.
Mm-hmm.
Did any of those voices kind of go through your head too, in terms of sort of the style, how she talked?
Well, I mean, you do have to imitate the style of that time frame to make it historically correct. Okay. You know, when the copy editor was going through, she said, she's young, she goes, "What is dadgummit?" just killed me. Yeah, you have to, you know, get the language down for that era. But no, I'm not sure I was so influenced by television or anything because I don't like cooking at all, and I don't watch cooking shows. And I know. And I know my agent was so unimpressed when she's a real foodie, and she's married to Stanley Tucci. He's a real foodie. So she's, oh, what do you like to make? Nothing. But I don't watch cooking TV shows, so I didn't want to start watching them because I didn't want those shows to influence me.
Yeah, definitely not the current. I was just thinking sort of that those old black and white shows from back then, and you could, just the way they spoke, at least in television, not necessarily real life,
but
who knows. So it's called Lessons in Chemistry. What did this whole writing the book, having the book come out, seeing it have such success, what did it teach you?
It taught me, you know, that perseverance actually works. I think when you're a writer, you just feel like you're just slaving away all the time and it's not going to work, but actually it does work. Writing a novel, copywriting to me is like a sprint, and then writing a novel is like running five marathons. I hit the wall a lot.
Mm-hmm. We just have about 5 minutes or so left before we take questions from the audience, but there's an Apple TV series coming out.
Yep.
Which is going to be great fun to watch. I've got my Apple TV. Do you have much control of the scripts, or what's your...
Well, I'm a co-executive producer, which I think sounds pretty special, but actually it means do nothing. And, you know, they are so great. They've been really great to me. I did read all the scripts, and I did make notes, and the deal is you can make as many notes as you want, and the deal is they don't have to take them.
Is there anything that we haven't talked about before we get to questions that you would like to share with our audience about your experience, or maybe your family, your sisters, your daughters, your husband, your dog?
Do you really want me to tell them our secrets?
How about the dog? Talk about your dog and 630 and here and your dog... 99.
Well, 99 right. has nothing to do with 630, except they're both number names. It's very confusing to everyone. 99 is from Get Smart. Surely everyone knows 86 and 99. But 630 was based on our dog Friday.
That's right, Friday.
Yeah, and Friday has passed on, but she was absolutely brilliant. We got her from the Seattle Animal Shelter. Our children picked her out. She was the ugliest dog in the pound. And, of course, our precious children said, isn't she beautiful? She didn't have any teeth on the bottom. She'd been very badly abused. her previous owner went to jail for burning cigarettes and cutting her. He was horrible. And she came to live with us. We did not teach Friday a lot of words. She learned them sitting at our table, because this is how she sat with us at dinner. It was like a ping pong match, almost. She would be like this. Who's ever talking? Aww. She's looking at you. And she was really smart and picked up a lot of words. But my favorite example of how smart this dog was I always took her to work with me. And one day I couldn't find my keys. And I was running around the house saying, where are my keys? Where are my keys? And Friday just looked at me like, and she went and she looked through my briefcase, and then she went and looked through my gym bag. And then I'm just watching this dog, and then she goes in she opens the closet, starts looking in my pockets. She finds the keys, throws them on the floor like, really?
Oh. Well, this has just been so much fun. There are so many things we could talk about. When I Googled you, you've been interviewed in so many different ways with book clubs and NPR and all of the different ways of talking about books and stories and writing. And I've just really enjoyed being here. And it's been wonderful to see such a great crowd. I think we're going to open it up for some questions. Are we ready for that? Okay, well, thank you so much, Bonnie.
Thank
and
you.
I think we're going to, let's hear some questions.
Thank you.
And if we don't have any, I always have questions. Never too short on questions.
My microphone is on. So if anybody has a question and wants to come stand over by me, come on down. She's going, no, that's not me. I'm not asking a question. And we'll get to as many as we can.
So I'm very interested in your rowing experience. I come from a family of rowers. And
yay.
Where do you row?
Well, I rowed 2 days ago in Seattle. It was really cold, and I heard a new sound in the oar locks, which was ice breaking.
Oh, yeah.
I row in Seattle. I also rowed in Switzerland. And I really want to row in London, but when I decided which team to join, COVID hit and all the teams shut down. And now I'm too busy to row in London. But I was just in Seattle, and I rowed almost every day that I was there.
Great. Did you ever row with the men in an eight?
Oh, yeah. In fact, weirdly enough, I was in London erging one day, and this guy plops down beside me, and you don't want to erg next to somebody who doesn't know how to erg, right? And so he plops down beside me, and turned out he was really good, and we did this huge piece together, perfectly in sync. And afterwards, he goes, you don't remember me, do you? And I said, no. And he goes, we were in a co-ed Masters 8 race, and you were beside me at the start line. We were both at strokes of our boat. And he said, you turned to my boat, and you said, have a nice race. And I said, what was wrong with that? And he said, that is trash talking. And I said, I think I remember that race, and I think my boat won. And he goes, yeah, it did. Anyway, I see him all the time now.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, my question's about the narration, because I listen to the audiobook on Audible. And personally, I love Miranda Raisin's voice in it. She was just great. But my question is, did you have any choice in picking the narrator? Mm-hmm. And did you think that she represented Elizabeth Zott's voice the way that you wanted?
Yeah, I had a choice of 5 narrators, and I listened to all their audio tapes, and I felt like she hit it out of the park. By the way, she didn't tell me this because I never saw her in person. It was during COVID. But the last 50 pages, her water broke. She was in labor, and she read a little faster.
I haven't heard it yet. I want to listen to that. That would be great. Okay. Thank you.
Hi. I am actually in a leadership class, and we are reading your book. And I'm about halfway through it, and I would love to know what leadership lessons should we be taking from Elizabeth Zott?
I think the biggest one is learning the power of the word no. You know, being able to stand up for yourself and not always being people-pleasing or, you know, trying to reach a consensus, but trying to reach that elusive, sensible thing that maybe we should all just be trying to get to. Elizabeth Zotta's logical, and she's a rationalist. And so I think more and more I'm very much attracted to people who kind of cut through the sort of things that we go through a lot today. There's a lot of political correctness in the world, and some of it is okay, and some of it is really irritating and takes a lot of time. And I think she has less time for that.
Great, thank you. Hi, Bonnie, thanks for coming. Sorry we couldn't entertain you with better weather for this weekend. Elizabeth is amazing and strong and brilliant and loved her, but aside from the abusive alcoholic husband, I really loved Harriet. She's a caretaker. She jumped right in and saw Elizabeth's need, and that really resonated with me. Did you have somebody like that in your life, maybe raising your daughters, moving abroad, that kind of thing, and how did that relationship and that character develop for you?
I just really wanted to shine a light on an older woman who was going to help a younger woman who did not want to be a mother. And, you know, they're very, very opposite, you know, and Elizabeth is well-educated and Harriet is not, but who's doing most of the teaching here? Harriet is. They end up helping each other, but I needed Elizabeth to realize that the women at home were striving to accomplish something. You know, she didn't want to be in their club, and then she was. And then she became the leader of their club.
Yep.
So,
yep.
You know, I think it was Harriet, though, that had to teach her that she had to have respect for those women.
Yep. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hi. I play tennis, and before each match, I wish my opponent a good match, have a good match. And so now I'm going to think twice about doing that. didn't occur to me that could be trash talk. One of the things that I noticed about your book is that characterization seems to come really easy to you. And I don't know if you feel that it does come easy to you as an author when you're writing. And so I was curious, maybe you're influenced by other writers for whom characterization comes easy. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about characterization, how you come to it, and who your favorite authors are, who you like to read.
Well, you know, I was really lucky to have parents who really encouraged reading, and I started reading a lot, and I just never really stopped. The authors I really admire are the authors who have excellent craft, and characterization is part of that craft. So I was really heavily influenced by everybody from Tolstoy to John Irving when I was growing up. And, you know, I love Roald Dahl, and I love Donna Tartt, and I love Barbara Kingsolver, and all of these people, they all have the same thing in common. They write really well, and they drag you into the story, and you don't want to leave it. And so that was one of my goals. But I think in my book, you know, Elizabeth Zott is the catalyst for every other character in the book. Whoever she comes in contact with, she changes, and that's the meaning of chemistry. So when I was writing her, I wanted to have all these points of view so you could watch the change.
Thank you.
Bonnie, is it true that your childhood piano teacher is here with us tonight?
My childhood piano teacher is right here in the front row, Marianne Chassé, the best piano teacher in the world. And I'm really honored that she came all the way here tonight. Thank you, Marianne. Talk about having a role model for me, Marianne.
Hi, I actually have two questions. The first is Elizabeth Zott, her background is in STEM. Mm-hmm. I know yours isn't necessarily a background in STEM. So for a book that's a lot on anti-sexism, is there a reason why you went with a female character that her background is in STEM?
So is your question that you wonder why I made her a scientist?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I wanted to make her a scientist because I wanted to put her on TV. And I felt at that time a woman could only be on TV if she was doing something like home ec or suggesting that we explore what's behind door number two. And so I wanted to make her a chemist, because if she was going to teach cooking, you have to, that is chemistry. Every time you turn on the heat, you're starting a reaction. You're breaking a lot of bonds, and then you recreate new bonds, and then you put that on a plate, and that is called dinner. So every single time you cook, you're a chemist. So it made sense to me to make her chemist, but then I had to learn chemistry, and that was this huge drawback.
Well, I thoroughly enjoyed it. Chemistry is like one of the things that I really enjoy. So for her to have like the background in chemistry, I was like super excited about. And then my second question was, you mentioned that you had started a novel initially about Mads. Are you going to circle back around to it, or are you just going to leave it be?
I'm not circling back to it right now. I should never bring up that other novel, because people go, what does Mad become? And I know what she becomes, because I know. But that's how I knew how to write her as a child.
Yeah, she was definitely top notch.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. A novel.
Are you working on it? I guess I'm the... Oh, okay. I really enjoyed your development of Calvin. And I was just so distressed when he passed away. And I was wondering why you decided to end his life when you did.
Well, he had to go. No, I know that sounds just horrible. I loved Calvin. But this is a story about a woman standing up and being who she is. And she, a woman at that time, would have never been given credit for her work. It would have always been accredited to him. So, sorry.
Hi, as an engineer, one of the things I loved most about Elizabeth Zott was her pragmatism, but I also loved the areas where you really dove into the things that she chose to be complex and precise and describe those tasks. My favorite one being her coffee making at home. So I wanted to know if there is any specific symbolism behind the coffee being such a complicated scientific task, and whether you actually made coffee that way to be able to write it.
No, I go to Starbucks. No, the funny thing about the coffee scene, it took me almost a week to research that and write it. And then when the book came out, I got probably 3 different direct messages from chemists, 2 in the United States and 1 in England, said, that is exactly how I make my coffee. It's weird.
Hi, I read your book. It's magnificent.
Thank you.
And I wanted to know if you have ever run into anybody in all your travels that knew an Elizabeth Zott.
That knew a Elizabeth Zott?
Yeah, someone just like your character.
No.
No.
No one's ever said that to me. I kind of think that there are Elizabeth Zotts in the world. I think Greta Thunberg is an Elizabeth Zott.
Well, I'm asking this because my mother was the epitome of Elizabeth Zott, exactly the same time period, and one of the few pictures I have of her, and it's in here, is of her standing there with her trousers and her French twist. The only thing she's missing is your pencil in her hair. She was a chemist here in San Diego, working at Kelco Company that used to convert kelp into food products, and that's what she did.
Oh.
And was raising 3 daughters and cooking from scratch every night. Every night. I mean, never substituted lemon juice or frozen spinach. It was from scratch every night. And I just wanted to thank you, because it really gave me an insight to what she went through.
Oh.
You know. And yeah. I found a letter of hers to me talking about how she couldn't break the glass ceiling in chemistry, couldn't get hired at Scripps Research. There was another paragraph about the reconciliation of intelligentsia with religion, that she'd found this someone. And then in the margins, this is a letter to me when I was at Berkeley in 68. Was the recipe for her pie crust. The recipe for her pie crust, and then on the back was the recipe for her cookies.
Oh.
So she did everything that you did, and I thank you for the insight into.
Thank you for sharing that.
If you want to see your picture, I have it.
Well, that was a great one to end on. Bonnie, thank you so much for coming to Coronado. It's been a wonderful event, everybody. Round of applause.